I was going to derive a couple of expressions that they show in the book, and you might be able to follow along with what the book is doing just fine, but I thought it would be helpful to make a quick video on how they actually arrive at that. We're interested in a projectile path, something that is traveling through the air on some XY graph, which is Y, positive Y to be up, and positive X to be to the right. This object, let's say it's a soccer ball that's being kicked. It has a initial velocity in the same direction that it's initially traveling, right? So right up this way, it's tangent to that path, just like we talked about several times in class. And the velocity at any point along here is always going to be in the direction tangent to what that path is. You can see this, it breaks down, it has two different components, right? It has a, that might be useful, it has this this x component here, so this is our initial velocity. It has an x component, it also has a y component, right? So there's an x component here, and a y component, so you can break that down, and the reason into those different components, it's the reason we want to be able to do that is that we know something, the motion of these two things is different in each direction. In the x direction, we don't have any acceleration. The gravity only acts in the vertical direction, down, negative y in this particular case. And there is acceleration in the y direction, so we want to have the freedom to be able to split those two things up, but please split those two directions up and write about them individually. Okay. My wife just got back from the store.
Oh, sorry.
So the first part that we want to know is something about the range, right? The maximum range that this object is going to travel. And it's really just some distance, and your book calls it capital R to be the range. A useful thing, your book starts out talking about, all right, well, if we want to know the range, how will we find that out? Well, the range distance equals rate times time, right? We have this displacement equals our velocity times some change in time. And so if we want to figure out what this displacement r is, we simply need to multiply it by the initial velocity in the x direction, because that doesn't change. Take that value times the total length of time it happens to be in the air, and that will tell us what the range is, right? So this is going to be, this delta x equals capital R, and this delta t is the time that it's in flight. And your book actually uses a capital T. You can use, like we talked about in class, the variables are simply markers, right? They simply, this is what we call it. I like to use subscripts a little bit more frequently. We could use a capital T just like your book uses. It doesn't really make any difference. You could also use here, say, you know, delta X range is a subscript of range as opposed to using a different letter. It's whatever you feel on your work and your homework, as long as I can see clearly what it is that you're doing, I don't have a problem with you making up whatever symbol that you would like. So we need to be able to figure out what this flight time is. And the flight time actually is going to depend on what the vertical velocity is. So the larger the initial velocity is in the vertical direction, the longer it's going to be in the air. Because if it's very large, it needs to slow down. It's going to be slowing down because it's accelerating downward until it reaches zero, and then accelerate. It's always be accelerating, but then the velocity goes from being negative and decreasing to now, well, upward and decreasing to being downward and increasing. So what's that going to look like? So we can write a similar expression here for the change in y. Right, the displacement in y is going to equal the initial velocity in the y direction times time plus 1/2 the acceleration in the y direction times time. And what we want to know is, when is this displacement going to be zero? Because it starts off here, we can call this initial point zero, and this final point also zero. So we want to evaluate this expression for when the displacement is equal to zero, because we want to know when that is. Oops, I forgot a squared. I hope everybody saw that, right? There's a nice little squared there. And so we have the initial velocity in the y direction times our total flight time, right? The time of the flight, plus 1 half times the acceleration in the y direction. We know the acceleration in the y direction for this particular problem is a negative g, because we're counting positive y as up. So that's negative g times the flight time squared. Right? There is a, this is the flight time here, the flight time squared, and a zero on this side. We can start to evaluate this by dividing everything here by a time squared, a flight time squared. So we divide both the left and the right side, all these different pieces, by this time, the time of the flight, right? Time of the flight. And this will cancel here. This is zero divided by any number would be zero still. And one of the time, the flight times here on the rightmost term goes away. So that's going to give us zero equals the initial velocity in the y direction. We can draw that minus sign out in front now, put minus 1/2 g and the flight time. And now we simply have a very basic algebraic expression, which we can solve for t. Right, we want to know what the flight time is. The flight time is going to equal, we put the negative vi y on the left side, so we subtract vi y from both sides. And that will give us, these will cancel out, gives us negative viy, and then we're going to divide by negative 1/2 g, and we get an expression that looks like this. The flight time is equal to 2 times the initial velocity in the y direction divided by g. Right? And it, the book takes it one step further, this initial velocity in the y direction, because of the way that we drew it up here, right? This actually has a vector, and that depends on the angle at which this is fired. So we can simply use a sine function. This is the viy is, there's a right triangle here, right? I'll draw it a little bit bigger so we can see it. The initial velocity has this magnitude in this direction, theta. Oops, sorry, that's just the initial velocity at some angle. It has an x component that is the adjacent side, and the y component, which is the opposite side. All right, so we simply use sine theta, so vi, let's write that real quickly, the sine theta is equal to vi y over vi. So if we want to solve for vi y, we simply multiply vi by both sides. And then we can plug that into here and get a more general expression of 2 times the initial velocity times the sine of theta divided by g. All right, and that's our flight time. I'm going to stop this here and then start it again for a second video.